Now, in one place in the secret Advaitam, Sri Aurobindo speaks of this hymn of creation, X-129, Mandala 10, hymn 129. Darkness hidden by darkness in the beginning was this all. Darkness, that is inconscious, salilam aprakitam, an ocean without mental consciousness, an ocean without mental consciousness. Now, see, an ocean without mental consciousness, he says. Now, he says ocean. Now, you just imagine the very first verse of Savitri, a fathomless zero occupied the world. A fathomless zero occupied the world. That is how the opening passage starts in Savitri. A fathomless zero, zero, shunya, nothing. That is the state and the condition. He says fathomless. Now the word fathomless had a connotation of water. Fathom, you do the measurement of depth of water, you see. Fathomless zero. So it is that ocean without this thing. It is that which is described in the very first, on the very first page of Savitri. A fathomless zero occupied the world. Shalilam aprakitam, it is that reference you see in the very first canto. A darkness hidden by darkness, out of one was born by the greatness of its energy, by his tapas was born. It first moved in it as a desire, which was the first seed of mind. A desire, yes, I want to be many or whatever you call it. The masters of wisdom found out in the non-existent, where that which be self-existent. In the heart, they found it out. I am purposely impersonal. Their way was extended horizontally. There was something above, there was something below. That is how the masters of extension then. Now this is very terse statement of Nasudeva Sukta about the beginnings of this creation. And about the purpose it has in its great objectives. The present canto in Savitri puts the entire thing in the totality of its perspective. That is what the canto is doing. It is an essay in poetry. Yes, it's a long canto, 931-963 lines. It's a long essay, but very systematically the idea is developed, you see, like an essay in poetry in the modern phrase and idiom. Recognizable and decipherable by the mind of our age, you see. We can understand that, you see. Nasudeva Sukta don't understand, but here, this is a possibility of what was taken as implicit by the Vedic contemporaries. Yeah, Vedic contemporaries, they understood immediately. A kind of a little hint, little word, little phrase was enough for them to connect everything. But here, we need a long essay, you see. By the Vedic contemporary, a kind of common knowledge of the race and the tradition has been made explicit in this canto, in Savitri. Now, a death-bound littleness is not all we are. So this is the creation. Now we have come to this point. Yes, we are here, but we are not simply death-bound creation. We are something more than that. We are deathless, and it is that which has to be discovered and established. Immortal, our forgotten vastnesses, but await discovery in our summit cell. Yeah, our highest possibilities, highest urges, highest longing, highest yearning, they are aspiring for that kind of a thing, you see. Unmeasured breadths and depths of being are ours. We are not just ignorant, gloomy, unhappy picture. There are glories awaiting for us, and we are waiting for them. Ashwapati comes as eternity's delegate, but what is he delegated with? Ashwapati has come here. Well, we'll skip some of these things. Ashwapati comes here to bring down the divine power so that this creation goes out of it, you see. The Supreme Himself must step into the mortal creation and strengthen the call of the divine origin, the urge, the aspiration, the flame, and carry it to the divine executive. Ashwapati's birth is to carry the call, carry the world's desire, to the Supreme. He steps into mortality in full identification with the sorrowing and transient lot. He takes the mortal birth. He does yoga tapasya and carries the worst desire, the original desire born in the void, carries it back to the transcendental Supreme. That is what Ashwapati is coming here for, carrying it. And he is now doing that thing. He takes the mortal birth as human first. His soul is released from mortal ignorance. His birth as a seer occurs. This is followed by his becoming a demigod. He becomes a demigod with that kind of a thing already, you see, Ashwapati, you see. He has taken the mortal birth, he has become a demigod immediately, within a few years, within a few months practically. But his spirit should also now be free from the working of the ignorant nature. His soul is released but free, nature. The journey begins, Ashwapati's journey now begins, the real work, you see. A safe place, memory lingers in a still. We are here, but you see, we are not really fully aware, but there is always something in us. Can this be all? Can there not be divine light? Something always there, you see, prompting them. And sometimes when our sight is turned within, us ignorant veil is lifted from our eyes. There is a short, miraculous escape. We escape from here completely. With the release of his soul from ignorance and with the attainment of demigodhood, Ashwapati is standing on a height that looks at greater height. Yes, this is there. Now greater height, what are the greater heights? What are you looking there? That those glories which are up there, those spirit potencies which are locked up there, they should come down here. That is what you are looking at. They are the ascending peaks of the spirit. Consciousness rising above consciousness. Voice rising above miraculous world. But they remain concealed. Yes, they are there, but they are not visible to us. They remain unreached. They remain unrealized. The spirit remains tied to the governing of the lower nature. Yeah, that is the whole problem is here. The spirit is tied to the lower nature. That is the whole problem is here. And it is easy for the soul to get released from ignorance, but to get freedom from nature's working here, inconscient nature working here, is the real problem. In fact, the whole of integral yoga is for this particular purpose. Moksha, release of soul, is easy. It has been happening, have been done also. But what about physical nature? Vital nature is inconscient nature. In the cosmic working, it is still she who operates. Ashwapati recognizes the grim fact. His spirit must become free from these forces, the forces of the lower nature, apara prakriti. Ashwapati has first to deal with the relationship of nature and spirit. So he has to understand now the connection between spirit and nature. And the whole canto is really focusing on that. He and she, nature, dual power, all those things are constantly there, you see. The dawn has already appeared on the horizon of Ashwapati. But the sun of truth and knowledge and power is yet lingering. It has not come into play here. Lingering beyond the visible reach. Soul's release, yes. Demigodhood, yes. But there are shadows of what must come. What must come, that is important. The necessary beginning is made. In fact, the entire thrust of Shivendur integral yoga is here. The entire thrust of integral yoga is here, you see. The quest is, we are not just a littleness bound by death and ignorance. We need not be condemned forever to mortality. Or a revealing force speech blazing in. Now, Ashwapati's thing, what happened? A revealing force speech blazing in out of some vast superior continent from somewhere higher realm. If so, knowledge breaks through, thrilling the radiant sea, and nature trembles to the power, the flame. You see, already something is happening. Great things are already happening to nature, you see. We may not be aware of it. We may even fail to look within. Yet the earthly consciousness moves towards greater and higher light. Yeah, that is the, and that is the force of evolution, and it is moving constantly forward. You see, there is something in us which constantly moves forward. We be sky touching temples to the Godhead, the high spires of the churches rise to touch the sky, high gopurams of the temples rise to touch the sky, you see, towers of the Godhead yourself. Our souls visit regions of imperial and imperishable splendor and joy, and reach peaks of silent power, and cross oceans of fathomless bliss, and breathe in the calm immensity of space, space. Sometimes the mystery elicits a human vessel, and who are these honorable cherished? Yeah, but a greater personality takes possession of our will and feeling and thought. Sometimes it happens. We are possessed by something. The undesirable guest we have been honoring, we have been harboring within in our subconscious cellar, then we have been entertaining the cherished enemy friend. They now vacate the place and make room for the power of the spirit to work. See, we have been holding cherished gifts. When the inner lamps are lit and the cherished gifts are allowed. See, the inner lamps are lit, the cherished gifts. Who are the cherished gifts? Who are these cherished gifts? Shatripur. They are called six blemishes, repetition. These seven sins are the Christian seven sins of ethical misconduct. The Indian psychology speaks of Shatripur, six blemishes. The Christian psychology speaks of seven sins, you see. What are these? Kama, krodha, mada, moha, matsara, lobha, or wrath, greed, sloth, pride, lust, envy, gluttony. These are the vital shatripus of the life forces. But then there are also blemishes of the physical nature, tamas, inertia, not to move, or the mental rigidities. Those are also blemishes. They have to go away, you see. He is talking only of the vital instincts which are present in us, but then there are physical difficulties, there are mental difficulties also. They have to go away. These are the powerful elements of the subconscious of life, and it is necessary that these be transformed into corresponding virtues of timeless glory. The divine presence then moves the soul, Ashwapati's spiritual progress moves towards it. Then the small bodily ego, when that has happened, when these cherished gifts are thrown out, the small bodily ego fails. No more listening to the separate self, losing the punctilio of separate birth, it lives as one with nature and God. Yeah. So now you are in companion of God and nature. Once these gifts have gone away, a greater personality sometimes possesses the personality whom we do not know. Who is yet a consciousness widened, the truth that we did not know until now unveils itself, our minds hushed to a bright omniscient. See, this is the kind of progress we made when the guests are out. Our minds hushed to a bright omniscient. A voice calls down from the chambers of the soul, the immortal fire burn with golden ecstasy. Well, this is a great miraculous thing when the guests are thrown out, you see. Ashwapati lives in the larger self, the diviner presence. What matters are nature and God and nothing else. That is what matters now, nature and God. The inner lamps are lit, the darkened rooms have become bright. The undesirable, unwelcome guests whom we cherished all along have taken their leave. See, a wider consciousness is open. If the four horsemen, who are the four horsemen? The tradition speaks, the occult tradition of the West speaks of pestilence, war, famine, death. These are constantly had to stride across the field. Then nothing else should come. Only their defeat. What should matter is the defeat of these four horsemen. What should matter is the defeat of pestilence, war, famine, death. These are the symbolic representation of the nature of God here. This is the Christian physiology, you see. In it, to be saved, the unbound divinity. There is the magic key for this miraculous change, for defeating this horseman.